special Catholic Drive Time
with Joe McLean and Emily Alcaraz.
But joining us right now by Zoom chat is the self-proclaimed dad of Catholic Twitter, Eric Sammons. Good morning, Eric. Thanks for being a part of our program.
Good morning. I do want to say I didn't self-proclaim it. I was given that title, and I embraced it, though.
You embraced it, lovely. Well, we're going to have a conversation, because Twitter's out of control, Dad. Okay, so I think some
I know I'm not doing a great job, am I? The kids are just very unruly these days.
Twitter is a blood sport. It needs some time out, is what it needs. But
Exactly right.
But that's not why we're here today. Eric, I'm grateful you're on the program today. We're talking about the old evangelization. You know, with the last couple of decades, we've sort of focused on the new evangelization. Maybe we can start by making distinctions. What is the new versus the old? Eric Sammons.
Well, the new evangelization, the term comes from Pope John Paul II. And it was the idea that he understood, and most Catholics, faithful Catholics understood, especially in the 1980s, something was wrong. That the changes that had been made in the 1960s had not resulted in what people had hoped they'd result in, this new flowering of the faith, that people would be becoming Catholic and the Catholic Church would be a leader in the world. In fact, the exact opposite was happening. People were leaving in droves, and the church's witness to the world was decreasing. And so his idea was, we need something new. And so that was the original idea. But what's happened is, over time, the term new evangelization has become this umbrella term that involves just any new idea somebody has. Like, okay, we're in a completely different situation, so we're just going to do things completely different than we've ever done it before, and we're going to call that new evangelization. And I don't think that was John Paul II's intention when he came up with the term, but that's what it's become in fact. And so when I wrote the book Old Evangelization, my idea was simple. It was just the idea that, you know, the church has been evangelizing for over 1900 years before the 1960s, and it had a lot of success. I mean, if you look at, for example, the Jesuit missionaries going to the New World, going to the every end of the earth. I mean, it was the church that, of course, evangelized Europe. And so all these things, we should look back and see, okay, how was it done by them? And even more particularly, I want to go back to the source. How did Jesus himself evangelize? And when we look at the model of Jesus, we see that's how the great evangelists like a St. Paul or St. Francis Xavier, how they evangelize. So we use that to basically return to our roots and how we've evangelized in the past. And I believe, even though the world changes in many ways, people are the same. And so I believe that the old evangelization would still work today.
I got to be honest. The last, 5 years or whatever, it seems like there's been an uptick on experimentations, I'm using air quotes here, experimentations of reaching and meeting people where they're at. I mean, Pope Francis, one of the first things that he said as Pope was to smell like the sheep, encouraging priests to smell like the sheep. And I think that's a fine statement, to smell like the sheep, meeting them where they're at. But it seems to me that on the whole, we have forgotten that our job doesn't end when we meet them where they're at, that we are supposed to continue to take them where they're supposed to go, thus towards Christ and salvation. What say you, Eric Sammons?
Well, absolutely. So if you see somebody in the gutter, you might have to go down into the gutter to get them. And so you're meeting them where they're at. But you don't live down there with them. Or you don't say, hey, you know, you're doing great down here. I'll see you later. Instead, what you do is you pick them up and you bring them out of the gutter and you help them. You do whatever you can help them. It's like the Good Samaritan didn't just say, hey, I'm going to sit there with you. You've been beat up. You're there on the side of the road. Good job. Attaboy. Keep at it. And then walk away. No, what you do is you take them, put them on your donkey. You take them to the inn. You get them taken care of. And I do think that's exactly one of the biggest problems we have, is that there's such the idea that the church needs to be like the world in order to evangelize the world. But if you think about it, that really makes no sense. Why should we try to be, if we're going to be like the world, why would the world have any desire to be like us? Because we're being like them. And so it just makes no sense. But that is the argument. In fact, that's the argument for a lot of things that have happened over the past few decades. The church is like, okay, we need to tone down certain aspects of the faith, certain aspects of how we worship, all these different factors, so that we'll be less offensive, perhaps, or less confusing to the outside world. But the problem is, then when we become like them, they have no incentive to be interested in us. They're like, well, they're just like us. So why should I bother becoming Catholic if I can just live the way I am now and I'm just like them?
So, Eric, we've been talking a lot about censorship here. How do you evangelize to a culture that doesn't even want you to have a voice?
Well, that is the challenge. I mean, we were just talking about Twitter. And of course, as soon as you start going into certain subjects on Twitter, you will automatically get shut down. I think what it is is that, first of all, the primary way we evangelize is person to person in real life. Now I am sounding like the old dad, get off my lawn, this new technology. But obviously I embrace the new technology.
Eat your green beans, darn it.
Yeah.
That's right, exactly. But the truth is that the most powerful evangelization is always person to person. And in real life isn't as easily censored as stuff that big tech controls. So I'd say that's the first thing is evangelizing your circle of influence, meaning the people you're around the most, your family, your neighbors, your friends, those that you have actual personal contact with. That's the primary way to evangelize. And that's very difficult to censor through some type of third party. It's possible, but not, it's more difficult. And I think what we do is we just proclaim the truth the best we can. We try to adapt if we can when it comes to censorship. But I noticed you mentioned that you were on Parler. And that's an example where we might just have to move around. I mean, it might be where Twitter becomes a situation where you just simply can't proclaim the gospel anymore.
Well,
and we all get kicked off.
Parler is an interesting topic because, yeah, you're right. If you're a conservative, if you want to espouse conservative a voice, an opinion, you're welcome to do that on Parler. But if you espouse an opinion that says transgenderism is harmful to the people who are living in that situation and detrimental to society at large, they'll censor you there as well. We've already seen some of that going on Parler. So, I mean, censorship is a thing even on Parler.
Right. And I do think any centralized technology, meaning that it has one organization that controls it, is always going to end up being, it's going to have censorship involved. And it's going to have people that are beholden to certain powers that are going to be against Catholicism. I also think I'm into technology as well. I used to be a computer programmer, that there are some exciting new technologies coming out there, more decentralized, where you'll have a social media platform that's not controlled by anybody. And you actually do the settings of what you are allowed, what you want to see and don't see. Now, there's troubles with that because there's no censorship of pornography or evil, things like that. But it might be a situation where that might be where we just are heading. And it might be the best possible scenario where we just are in a situation where because you can censor, if you can censor porn, you can also censor Catholicism. And obviously we want the former and we don't want the latter. And so it just, when you live in a society that's as bad off as we are, you get lumped in with pornography. I mean, frankly, and that's what happens. That's the evil that we live in. But I think those are the challenges.
Eric,
I personally think we just have to boldly proclaim these things, even if we end up getting censored.
Eric, so we have 3 minutes before we have to go to break. But I had a question in regards. I read your book back in 2017 when it came out. And I was wondering, how has your ideas developed over the last 3 years? A lot has changed in the church. A lot has changed in the world. How has your ideas developed or changed since writing the book?
That's a great question. In fact, I was just thinking the other day, what would have been like if I wrote this book today compared to 3 years ago? And I think it would have had the same themes, but honestly, I think I would have been more blunt and direct that we also have to address the problems in the church. The McCarrick scandal came a year after this book was written. And that really, I kind of say, radicalized me in a certain sense, that we need to stop tiptoeing around the real and serious problems inside the church, because I think those are very harmful to evangelization. A lot of people say we shouldn't speak out against those things because that harms our witness, that people will see things are wrong in the Catholic Church, they won't want to become Catholic. I personally think it's literally the exact opposite. If we ignore these problems or try to shove them under the rug, people are smart. They see that. They don't want to have anything to do with that type of organization. Why would you want to be part of an organization that sweeps evil under the rug or acts like it's not there? So I think today I would change it only to say I would be more forthright about the fact that we need to explicitly condemn evil when it's in the church instead of tiptoeing around, no matter who does it, even if it's a cardinal, for example, like Cardinal McCarrick.
Yeah, we're talking with Eric Sammons. EricSammons.com is his website. We're talking about the old evangelization and the challenges facing the church to carry out its mission to evangelize the whole world, to go to the four corners to make disciples. Now, I see that you're a convert, Eric, and I, too, am a convert to the church. I grew up in the Church of Christ. Is that pretty much an agnostic heathen, though, for many, many years. And once I had a conversion experience and I gave my fiat, if you will, to the Catholic Church, I recall just thinking very naively that we're all on the same page. We're all on the same team, and we all think alike. And then two things happened. I realized that not every Catholic believed in the dignity of the human person from conception. And that shocked me. Like, how could you not? Like, that seems really strange to me. And then the second thing that shocked me was the Boston sex abuse scandal that broke in 01. And I was like, wait, there are priests involved in what again? Like, this, like, it was just mind-twisting to me to realize these things. Did you experience anything similar to that? We have about a minute, I think, before we go to break.
Yeah, I converted about 10 years before the Boston scandal, and it definitely was an eye-opener. That was an eye-opener. I actually, one of the reasons I converted was because of the pro-life witness of the church. And so when I saw Catholics who were not really standing up for the unborn, then that really did, that was scandalous to me. But it never really, since I had been Catholic for about 10 years before the Boston thing happened, I had already kind of seen problems in the church. Now, that was still eye-opening for me. But it didn't really shake my faith in the church itself.
I'm going to ask you to hold that thought right there, Eric. Sorry to cut you off, but we got to go to break. We're going to come right back, continue our conversation with Eric Sammons. You can find more information about him at ericsammons.com. But that's coming up on the other side of the break right here on Catholic Drive Time, keeping you informed and inspired. We'll be right back. Praise be to Jesus Christ in all things. Welcome back to Catholic Drive Time, keeping you informed and inspired. By the way, tomorrow morning, we're going to have a great program starting at 6 a.m. Central, 7 Eastern. John Sorensen from Catholic Answers is going to be on to defend the traditional date of December the 25th as the birthday of Christ. Did you know there's a defense that could be made? Well, tune in tomorrow morning to get that, all coming up on Catholic Drive Time tomorrow. But right now, we're speaking with Eric Sammons, ericsammons.com. And you can also find him over on Twitter at Eric R. Sammons, and he is the dad of Catholic Twitter, which is in desperate need of some timeout. It's been so vitriolic lately. Eric, welcome back to the show.
I'm trying to do my best. Yeah. I'm going to have to start handing out punishments, I think.
I think so. I think so, for sure. You know, but doesn't that just speak to the condition of our deterioration in the evangelization of souls? I mean, whenever I speak out in defense of traditional marriage or abortion or anything that smells of anything conservative, all of a sudden, you know, the hate mail starts coming in, so to speak, or the Twitters fly or whatever. But have we forgotten we are supposed to, by mandate of Christ himself, to disciple the entire world? I think we've forgotten this.
I think our cancel culture that we live in has really impacted each of us, I think subconsciously, because what happens is we see how whenever somebody speaks out just a little bit, they just get a famous person, they get slammed. And so we don't want that to happen to us. So for example, like a year ago when J.K. Rowling, the author of Harry Potter books, who's not some conservative Catholic by any stretch of the imagination.
Not at all, yeah.
But she did say something that was basically against transgenderism. And it wasn't even that strong. It was good. I mean, I was glad to see her do it. Well, she just got slammed so hard. I mean, there was literal book burnings of the Harry Potter books for this. And it was just unbelievable that this happened. But we see that. We see this happen all the time. And so we think, if we say something publicly that might lead to that, we might lose our job. We might be shamed. We might lose friends. We might lose our relationship with our family members. And I feel like this is a real impact on evangelization. I've seen it actually for, you know, over 20 some years of doing this. I've seen this. It's just getting worse and worse where we hold back what we're saying because we're only concerned about how the other person will react.
Yeah.
When the truth is, we don't control how somebody else reacts. We only control what we say and how we say it. So, yes, we should always say things charitably. That is very important. But charitably does not mean that you don't say the truth.
Right.
In fact, charity demands often in many situations that you have to say that an uncomfortable truth.
Well, and
we're always thinking about the other person's reaction, but we need to be thinking, what? How do I say it? What do I need to say?
Right. And keeping this all in mind, we were talking about Twitter. Is it possible to evangelize on social media? I think we've all seen those Facebook fights that people get into.
That was exactly going to be my question.
Right. Yeah. Is it even possible to evangelize well and effectively on social media?
Evangelize with memes as the new evangelization?
With memes.
Yeah. I actually think it is. I know a lot of people say, oh, nobody's ever converted or ever changes their mind based on social media, but that's just not true. I know people who have been that have started, they've seen things on Facebook or Twitter and they have changed their view on something. So I do think it is possible. In fact, I think it's necessary. I don't think it's necessary everybody be on social media. In fact, I think if social media is bad for your spiritual life, get the heck away from it.
Amen.
Right? Yeah. At the same time, I do think some people are called to be there because that is where people are. And that is where evangelization needs to happen. We need to go out into the street, so to speak, smell like the sheep, and be with people and evangelize to them. Now, the key is it's difficult to do because social media is inherently, it's anti-human in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because you can't have these relationships. You don't see the facial cues. You don't see, you don't know the people. You don't have deep relationships. It's just like these... It's just like these little pictures on a screen is all of a sudden the entire person. And so it's very easy then to treat them like a picture on a screen rather than as a human person. And that's the real challenge that I think most of us fail at times. And we just try harder and harder not to fail and to treat every person we see as every person we interact with on social media as a real person. Like one thing I do is, when somebody attacks me on Twitter or wherever, I always tell myself, okay, I have to say a prayer for them. It can just be a quick Hail Mary or something. Yeah. But that then allows my reaction to be not one of just anger and quick response, but think, okay, this is a human person and they're attacking me for some reason. Probably they have some hurt or something wrong in their life.
Mm.
And so I need to remember that when I respond to them. Now I might fight back. I'm not, this doesn't mean we just sit back and allow people to attack us. We never say anything, but we do it with the sense of, okay, I'm trying to bring this person to conversion. I'm not trying to defeat them in some, with some cute social media quip or something like that.
This is why he's the dad of Catholic Twitter. That's great advice. And I had another question. So a lot of people have been coming to me and saying that it's become very difficult to evangelize because of all the problems that the church has right now, the corruption, the scandal. So, when we ourselves don't quite understand as lay people what is going on in the church, what do we have to offer to people who are looking at the church and saying, why should I join?
I think the first thing we have to do is we have to give a personal witness. This is fundamental to all evangelization. You see, St. Paul did this all the time. What does he do? He talks about how he was a Pharisee of Pharisees. He persecuted the Christians. He's giving his personal testimony of what Jesus did in his life. And I think if we're living as Catholics and we're trying our best to be faithful, then we're dealing with all these problems. How do we deal with it? How is it that you live your faith? Why do you still go to Mass? Well, if you explain it to somebody else, they see, okay, it is possible to bring together a life of faith, a life of prayer, of the sacraments, in conjunction with this evil that's going on in the church. And so I think you just explain how you deal with it, how you personally are able to continue to live a life of faith, even though bishops and priests and even the Pope at times are doing things that are contrary to the Catholic faith. I think when you explain your own witness, I think people respect that and they understand that.
It's definitely a difficulty, especially in what we do here and in this radio apostolate. Sharing the good, the true, and the beautiful, and then having to explain, you know, the term Pope-splaining has become a thing since 2013. And, you know, God love His Holiness Pope Francis, right? We pray for Pope Francis every single day. But the reality is there are very confusing things that are happening at the highest levels of the church that make it much more difficult for us to have to do what we do and explain some of these things. So moving forward, we have about, I guess, 5 minutes left in our program before we have to say goodbye to Eric Sammons here. Moving forward, what do you see is the future? What's 5-10 years down the road, Eric, especially as it pertains to evangelization? I'm thinking about, you know, we live in archdioceses that are massive now, all over the country and the world even. And yet I would imagine that if I polled the audience right now and I asked them, pop quiz, who is the director of evangelization in your diocese? Or how about this? What is the plan to evangelize your city that you live in? I bet if I'm a betting man, I bet they wouldn't even know the answer to either one of those questions. Eric, in that circumstance, how do we move forward? What's the future?
Well, okay, the evangelization comes from the root word evangelize, which is a Greek word that means share the good news. So it means the good news. However, my answer is going to be, I think we're going to see a lot of bad news. I honestly believe. Yes.
Aren't you awesome?
Good morning, Kathy.
He's definitely not the fun dad from the neighborhood.
And Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
But I honestly do believe that 10 years from now, so in 2030, I really do think, and I'm talking, I can only speak of my own experience, which is America. So I can't speak of other continents or countries. But I do think that in America, at least, that the Catholic Church in 10 years will be much, much, much smaller than it is today. Mm. I've looked at the numbers. I've studied them in depth. And what we see is we saw a decline starting around 1970 in, for example, infant baptisms. Mm. But it stayed somewhat steady until about 2000. And then it started to just fall off a cliff. And I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that I was the first generation that was raised completely post-Vatican II. I also think it has to do with the abuse scandal that, of course, came out early, you know, 2001, 2002. But what we're seeing is this drop is just astronomical in the past. We've almost cut the number of infant baptisms in America in half in the past 20 years.
Insane.
And that is insane. And so I honestly think that's going to continue. And I think, for example, this past year with COVID, with the witness of the bishops and shutting down all the masses, public masses for a long time, still having so many restrictions. And I know we can debate all the prudence of that. But I think what we've done is we've said as a church that mass is not essential. Mm-hmm. And I think people hear that subconsciously or consciously, they hear that. Mm-hmm. And I think fewer and fewer people will go to mass. So I honestly do believe we're in a situation where in the next 10 years or so, things are going to get bad. Now, to try to have some good news in that story.
Thank you.
I do think these are opportunities in which we can really strengthen the faith and have a dedicated core. I mean, Pope Benedict, years before when he was just Father Ratzinger, he predicted this, and I think it was 1970-ish, around mm-hmm. the late 1960s. He predicted exactly this would happen. And I think he was absolutely right. And he was saying, but what happens is in that death, which is really what it is, it's a death. We have a seed though that then grows that can flourish and become a truly vibrant and dynamic Catholic Church. Mm. But I do think a death is necessary because honestly, we have to get rid of a lot of the crap, to be honest, of the past decades. And I think that is going to happen naturally. Right. A lot of that stuff's going to fall away. But then from that, I really think we can have the means of a very...
The phoenix shall rise
Amen.
From the ashes.
There's hope.
There is hope. We're going to cut you off there, Eric Sammons from ericsammons.com or Eric R. Sammons on Twitter. God love you. God bless you. Thanks for being a part of our program today. God love you.
Thank you for joining us on Your Catholic Drive Time, where it is our pleasure to keep you informed and inspired.
Join us Monday through Friday at the same time, right here on your favorite Catholic radio station.
Don't forget to connect with us. Just go to facebook.com/Catholic Drive Time.
Again, that's facebook.com/Catholic Drive Time.
Be sure to share more than just us today. Share Jesus with everyone you meet.
Bye now, and God love you.